Okay, good evening. Glad everybody's back this evening. Let me go through just a few announcements with you. Ann Pryor remains in White County Hospital, but Ron said she's doing better and hopefully will go home tomorrow. So continue to pray for Ann. I know she's ready to go home. Evan Bates has a blood clot in his arm. Maybe you've seen some post about that this week. He was released from the hospital today, and they're going to keep a close eye on that arm. Laura Gray had surgery today, and I just received word from Colin that they're on their way home, so they may even be home by now. So had an outpatient surgery, and she is home. Dottie Williamson had surgery on Monday and is recovering. She's still at UMS and will probably be there through the weekend, I think. So. Also, Backpacks for Kids campaign is ongoing. Please consider making a donation to help us reach our goal of $10,000 to help students with their school supply fees. All right, let's pray, and then I will introduce our speaker. Yes, oh yes, your mother. Is that right? Barbara Williams will have surgery on Friday. Yeah, as soon as you raise your hand, I remember that. So keep Miss Barbara in your prayers. Surgery Friday at Big Baptist in Little Rock. All right, let's pray together. Our Father, we humble ourselves before you this evening. We love you so much, and God, we thank you for loving us. You've shown us your love so much by sending Jesus to the cross, and you continue to demonstrate your love to us through your grace continually. We're thankful, Lord, that Laura is her surgery went well, and she's on her way home, that Dottie's surgery was a success, and that Miss Ann is doing better. And Father, we pray that you'll be with Miss Barbara Williams as she has surgery on Friday. We pray that her surgery will go well, be a success, and that she will recover fully and be back to her normal activities in life. We're thankful you're the great physician and that you watch over all of us, Lord. And we're thankful we can bring our cares and our current concerns before you. Pray, Father, this evening as we block out our concerns and our cares for just a moment and focus on your word. Pray that you'll be with Nick as he speaks to us. Open our hearts and our minds as we look into your word, as we glean lessons from it. And Father, we know there are many others that are hurting throughout this world. We pray that you will be with them and offer them comfort, but we also pray that they will hear the gospel. We give you honor and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, Nick Hamilton is our speaker tonight, and I've been able to get to know Nick a little bit through our preacher luncheons, and I just think highly of him. He's been in ministry forever. I was looking at the dates today, actually, and I was looking at this. Well, I'll tell you this in a minute. His undergraduate work was at OCC, his graduate work at ACU there in Abilene. He preached at Pleasant Valley from 1976 to 1992, and I was thinking, that was my whole childhood, Nick. So that's yours too. So no, but that's a long time. That's really good. He was at Memorial Church in Houston from 92 to 99, and then here at Windsong in Little Rock from 2000-2004, and most recently was the pastoral care minister from 2004 to 2018 at Pleasant Valley. His wife Kathy, of 44 years, is with him this evening. They have two married daughters, five grandchildren, soon to be six. Is that right? So fantastic. We will turn it over to Jeff for some songs, and then Nick, it'll be your turn, and we look forward to hearing you preach.
Tonight, this is not only a delight for me to get to be with you, but a new experience. We've been in Central Arkansas for most of the last 40 plus years, and I think this is the first time that I've ever spoken at this church. So thank you. Thank you for the invite to come and be with you tonight. We get to see faces that we've known in days gone by, be with people that we've got special relationships from the past, either with them or some of their family members. And so it's a real treat to get to come. But beyond that, we actually owe this church. Our oldest daughter and son-in-law attended here for a couple of years, back 10 years ago or so. when he was teaching at Cabot Junior High South. And the impact of this church on them has been very positive, and we want you to know that we appreciate you for what you did in helping shape their life early on in their marriage. So it's just a treat to be with you tonight. It's such a treat that I don't even want to preach. So I don't think I will. I think we'll just do a Bible study. How about that? Got your Bibles? Open them to Acts chapter 13. We're going to draw our lesson from that tonight, one of the sermons that was preached by Paul. I won't preach, I'll let Paul do the preaching tonight. Acts 13 begins some traveling that Paul does, for which he may be best known in Scripture, that or his brilliant theological mind and the letters that he wrote to various churches. But generally, when you say his name, one of the first things you think of is the missionary journeys. And tonight begins the first of those. Up until now, most of the attention of the book of Acts has been on the Apostle Peter. There are a number of things that change in Acts 13. Paul's conversion has already been recorded. But not only is there a shift from looking at Peter's influence in the early church to Paul's, but you end up seeing a real shift even in some relationships that take place. Early on, he had been in Antioch, the church that sent him out. In the early part of Acts 13, he's made it all the way to Paphos, where he encounters some difficulty. He sails from there. In verse 13 of Acts 13, Paul and his companions put out to sea from Paphos and came to Perga in Pamphylia. But John left them and returned to Jerusalem. Now, there are a couple of things I want you to see. Number one, there's a real shift. Up until now, you've been reading, when you read about Paul and Barnabas, it's always been Barnabas and Paul, Barnabas and Paul. Starting in verse 13, it's Paul and Barnabas. Now, I wonder why that shift took place. We know the impact that Paul had, but maybe it just began at this point to really manifest itself, his leadership capabilities. And then you read at the end of that verse, John left them and returned to Jerusalem. Now, Luke, who writes the book of Acts, he's a kind-hearted soul, because that's not what Paul says in Acts 15. Paul doesn't say John left us. He says John deserted us. But Luke gives him some cover here, doesn't he? John Mark left. We don't know why. All kind of speculation I've read. He was a mama's boy. He was homesick. He didn't like that his cousin was now being overshadowed by Paul. He and Barnabas were cousins. We don't have a clue. All we know is that he upped and left, and that did not set well with Paul, not at this moment. So Paul has gone then from Paphos to Perga in Pamphylia. Now, to get there, he has sailed across the sea and probably landed at the port of Attalia, and from there would have had to walk about 7 miles upstream at the river to get to Perga. But he didn't stay long. Going on from Perga, they arrived in Pisidian Antioch, and on the Sabbath day they went to the synagogue and sat down. And you don't see here any real reason why Paul doesn't stay in Perga very long. Not going, he'll stay there longer coming back. But I think we can figure this one out. The book of Galatians is written, I think, to churches along the southern part of the land called Galatia in the New Testament, where these churches were. Now, if you look at the map, Perga is very low. It's swamp infested. A lot of mosquitoes there. Paul says in Galatians 4, in the letter to the churches, that he didn't have opportunity to stay with them that long because of his health. Most Bible scholars tend to think that what happened was Paul came down with something like malaria while he was there, and so had to get away from there as quickly as he could and go to the area up north of there, about 100 miles. And it's not an easy journey. So when you read he went from Perga to Pisidian Antioch in the area of Turkey today, you got to understand, this was a hard trip, and especially hard for a sick man. I mean, you not only have to go 100 miles, you got to climb 3,500 feet, because that's how high that Pisidian Antioch was. And there were no roads. There were trails, and there was a lot of wild animal activity. There were robbers. I wonder if that's what Paul meant in 2 Corinthians chapter 11 when he said he had been in peril of robbers. Maybe he was thinking about that particular trip that he made. But he finally gets there, and on the seventh day he goes into the synagogue and he sits down. And again, I wonder why Luke tells us that. Luke tells us in Luke 4 that when Jesus went to the synagogue, he stood there and read. But here, Paul sits down, and after reading the law and the prophets, the synagogue officials sent to them saying, "Brethren, if you have any word of exhortation for the people, say it." And now Paul stands up and motions with his hands to start his sermon. Okay. The synagogue, whose origins are unclear, but occurred between the end of the Old Testament and the beginning of the New, but play a prominent role in New Testament teaching. Every town, if there were 10 Jewish men, they had a synagogue. And their Sabbath day assemblies were all just cookie cutters of, you knew what was going to happen before you got there. You know, we laugh about two songs of prayer, another song. Well, they had a format. They read from the Torah. They read from the prophets. They had their prayers. And then they had what was called their lectionary. It was a speech that was to be given. It could either be given by the man who was in charge of the synagogue, or if he preferred, he could single out some other individual and asked them to give the lesson for the day. And it was not uncommon to invite a guest to speak, especially if that guest was a rabbi. Now, I don't know how well acquainted Paul and Barnabas had become with the people here and in that synagogue at this time, but you remember Barnabas' name was Son of Encouragement. Son of Consolation, that's what his name means. He was quite an encourager. And so there may have been something about him that just had been so refreshing to these people that when it came time for the lesson to be presented, whoever was in charge just said, "If you have a word of exhortation, a word of encouragement for us, come and speak," knowing Barnabas' nature. Paul gets up, and I don't know how well they had been exposed to the brilliance of his mind at that moment, but they're about to get it. He stands there among them, and he motioned with his hand, and again, I wonder exactly what happened. In my mind, I picture him doing something like this, getting their attention, calling them to order, and here's his sermon. "Men of Israel, you who fear God, listen. The God of this people Israel chose our fathers and made the people great during their stay in the land of Egypt, and with an uplifted arm he led them out from it. For a period of about 40 years he put up with them in the wilderness, and when he had destroyed 7 nations in the land of Canaan, he distributed their land as an inheritance, all of which took about 450 years. Now, pause at that point. There is nothing in the Old Testament that carries the weight in the mind of the Jews more than a single promise made in Genesis chapter 12. When God said to Abraham, I'm going to make of you a great nation, and through your descendants all nations of the earth will be blessed. They hung everything they had on that promise. That was more significant to them than anything you've ever experienced. It told them, number one, we're God's people. Abraham is our father. We have a special relationship with God that other people don't have. He has chosen us. We're his. They love feeling that way. You talk about feeling special when it is your view that God chose you above all others. Well, you can figure it out. And besides that, they had a land that God said to Abraham, I'm going to give it to you, far as you can see. And I'm going to make your descendants so hard to number, it'd be like counting sand on the seashore. There'll be that many of them. That's just a small family. And God's going to do all of that for them. But then the kicker. Through you, everybody will be blessed. And it happened. He talks about it right here. He made the people great during their stay in the land of Egypt. You think he's got to be talking about numbers because they ended up as slaves. But there were a lot of them. And even though it seemed like it at the time, God had not forgotten who they were. And they cried out continually, and finally, you remember through Moses, they are delivered. And they spend 40 years wandering in that wilderness. And while they're wandering in the wilderness, this people who were nobody's slaves, conquered mighty nations. It was something. And they get to back to their land, and it's going to be their land. Other people are living in it. They got to drive them out. They do. And the promise is, through you, all nations of the earth will be blessed, and they're going to lose that land again. But they're looking for the fulfillment of that part of the promise. And they're thinking, Messiah, deliverer, we're going to be great again, just like we were, as he'll talk about here in a moment, just like we were. That's going to be us all over again. And that one person he's going to send, he's going to make it happen. Boy, they lived for that. That was special. But for a period of 40 years, he had to put up with them in the wilderness. You ever felt like God has to just put up with you? Some translations say that God cared for them. I like that a lot better. I like to think that God hadn't had to put up with me as much as he's cared for me. Which is it? Well, honestly, I don't know. I looked it up this afternoon. I found out something interesting. The word that would be translated cared for, the word that's translated put up with, is a 16-letter word in the Greek language. And there's only one letter difference in the two words. I don't know which one he really intended. I don't guess it matters a whole lot. Yeah, it does. I want to think of him caring for us. So for 40 years, he cares for them when he destroyed the nations, distributed their land, all of which took about 450 years. Isn't it interesting that he notices the length of time that was involved in God fulfilling that promise? I'm going to give you this land. 450 years. After these things, he gave them judges until Samuel the prophet. Then they asked for a king, and God gave them Saul, the son of Kish, a man of the tribe of Benjamin, for 40 years. Now, again, there's a couple of things I want you to see in here. I'm glad that we read this, that Saul was their king for 40 years. Because you don't read that in the Old Testament. If it weren't for being told that now, we wouldn't know how long Saul had been their king. But there's something else I really want you to notice. You remember who's making this speech? Who's delivering this sermon? Paul? Yeah, you remember his name, Saul Little. He says here God gave them this King Saul, a Benjaminite. His name's Saul. And you remember Philippians 3? He's from the tribe of Benjamin. And I have wondered if that had anything to do with why he began to be called Paul. Maybe a disassociation from that other Benjaminite that had that name. Because he hadn't done well. I don't know. After he had removed him, he raised up David to be their king, concerning whom he also testified and said, I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after my heart, who will do all my will. We don't put epitaphs on tombstones much anymore. Now what we put is a name, date of birth, date of death, and that's it. I like to go through the old parts of cemeteries where they did inscribe things on tombstones. Have you ever wondered what yours ought to say? If you could design your own tombstone tonight, what inscription would you want on it? Let me tell you, I can't find a better one than, here lies a man who was after God's own heart. David was a remarkable individual. And from the descendants of this man, according to the promise, God has brought to Israel a Savior, Jesus. Now again, I want you to notice something. In their mind, when they thought of the promise that God gave to Abraham, that through him all nations of the earth would be blessed, they've lost that status, that standing they had when David was king and they ruled the world. They lost that. And they have been looking continually for a Messiah that would be the conqueror, the one who would place them back to that position that they thought was rightfully theirs because God gave it. And Paul, in preaching this lesson, says, the descendant of this man, according to the promise, God has brought, not a Messiah, oh, Jesus was. Paul says he brought a Savior. Now, really, which one do we want? Conqueror who will set us up in charge of all the other nations, or a Savior? After John had proclaimed before his coming a baptism of repentance to all the people of Israel, and while John was completing his course, he kept saying, what do you suppose that I am? I'm not he, but behold, one is coming after me, the sandal of whose feet I am not worthy to untie. Now, stop here a minute. John the Baptist was just a remarkable fella. You know, he dressed in that wild clothing, the skin of wild animals, ate locusts and honey for his diet. And everybody went out to hear him preach. And he had done such a remarkable job that several years later, in an area a long way away from where John lived, in a day when they did not have good communication like we do, these people had already heard about his ministry and the effect that he had on folks. I think that's remarkable. Now, could have been his clothing, could have been his diet, but it was his message. I got to tell you, incidentally, a good friend of mine, John Gibson, preached at Six and the Izzard for years. And Joe Barnett, who preached for the Broadway Church in Lubbock, very close personal friends, used to kind of throw barbs at each other in a fun way. Joe was named one of the 10 best-dressed men in Lubbock, Texas, when he was preaching for Broadway. John found out about it and just thought he'd have some fun. And he talked about Joe Barnett, Lubbock, Texas, one of the 10 best dressed men. Can you imagine? You reckon John the Baptist would have made the 10 best dressed men list? John learned you don't pick on Joe, because the next week in his bulletin article, Joe said, well, John wouldn't be named to the best dressed list in Lubbock, but he might in Arkansas. So, but what really carried John was the power of his message. He'd look at those people right in the eye, point his finger at them and say, repent. And they did. They came out in droves. And they were asking, what shall we do? Well, Paul, seizing upon what they must have heard about John, declares this and then says in verse 26, brethren, sons of Abraham's family, and those among you who fear God, to us the message of this salvation has been sent. For those who live in Jerusalem and their rulers, recognizing neither him nor the utterances of the prophets which are read every Sabbath, fulfilled by these by condemning him, and though they found no ground for putting him to death, they asked Pilate that he be executed. When they had carried out all that was written concerning him, they took him down from the cross and laid him in a tomb. He just sort of, as Peter did in Acts 2, recounts the fact and then adds this, but God raised him from the dead. The one that they had looked to maybe was their Messiah, but it had been killed by those Roman soldiers. At the insistence of their own leaders, he had been crucified. Can you imagine how those people felt the day that they put that lifeless body in that tomb and rolled that stone in front of the opening? Can you imagine how these people who had left everything to follow Jesus felt walking home from that cemetery? You've been there. You know the hurt. And then 3 days later, word begins to spread. Many days he appeared to those who came up with him from Galilee to Jerusalem, the very ones who are now his witnesses to the people. And we preach to you the good news of the promise made to the fathers, that God has fulfilled this promise to our children, in that he raised up Jesus, as it also is written in the second Psalm, you are my son, today have I begotten you. As for the fact that he raised him up from the dead, no longer to return to decay, he has spoken in this way, I will give you the holy and sure blessing of David. Therefore, he also says in another psalm, you will not allow your Holy One to undergo decay. For David, after he had served the purpose of God in his own generation, fell asleep and was laid among his fathers and underwent decay. But he whom God raised did not undergo decay. You've just listened to Paul preach a powerful sermon, something that he knows firsthand. Jesus, he has full knowledge, was crucified, and when he was buried, they gave up all hope until that third day. But how do you know? Paul knew. He had seen him on the road to Damascus. This isn't speculation on his part. It all clicked with Paul, and he's wanting it to click with them. God made a promise that through Abraham's seed, all nations of the earth will be blessed. And he sent someone not just to be their Messiah, but to be their Savior. And he can do it because he had conquered the tomb. And with that in mind, he says, therefore, let it be known to you, brethren, that through him forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you, and through him everyone who believes is freed from all things from which you could not be freed through the law of Moses. Therefore, take heed so that the things spoken of in the prophets may not come upon you. Behold, you scoffers, and marvel and perish, for I am accomplishing a work in your day, a work which you will never believe, though someone should describe it to you. Paul's saying, this is real. Don't discount it. Don't ignore it. This is the absolute truth. Don't be like the scoffers. God said, I'll send someone through the lineage of Abraham, and all nations will be blessed. It took centuries, but God did exactly what he said. And he raised him up so that he would not see decay. And he is now Savior. Through him you can have forgiveness. God fulfilled that promise he made. Okay. Don't be a scoffer. Let's stop here and let's go over to 2 Peter chapter 3. Verse 3. Know this first of all, that in the last days mockers will come with their mocking, following their own lust, saying, where is the promise of his coming? Ever since the fathers fell asleep, all continues just as it was from the beginning of creation. For when they maintain this, it escapes their notice by the word of the Lord. The heavens existed long ago, and the earth was formed out of water and by water, through which the world at that time was destroyed, being flooded with water. But by the word, the present heavens and earth are being reserved for fire, kept for the day of judgment and destruction of ungodly men. Do not let this one fact escape your notice, beloved, that with the Lord one day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years like one day. Folks, God promised to send a Messiah, a Savior. It took centuries, but he did it. And he promised to send that same one back again. And Paul is saying, don't be like the scoffers who just kind of wrote off God's promise long ago that the Savior would ever come. And Peter adds, And don't be like scoffers today who write off the idea that he's coming back. Basically, he's saying, if God made good on his promise once, you can count that he is going to make good on it again. So he says, the Lord is not slow about his promises, come count slowness, but is patient toward you, not willing for any to perish, but all to come to repentance. Here's the thing. I don't know when Jesus is coming, but I do know that he's coming. And I do know why he hasn't come to this point. I know why he hasn't come until tonight. Because God, in his infinite wisdom and holiness, unlimited in his knowledge, is looking from heaven and he sees that there's somebody who is very, very close to deciding to become his child. And he wants to give them that opportunity. I look at it this way. I am so glad Jesus did not come back on August the 31st, 1962. I wasn't ready. I got ready the next day. He delayed his coming, and that let me get right with him. And I think he's still doing the same thing tonight for someone. He isn't slow concerning his promise. He's long-suffering. He don't want anybody to be lost. Remember, he sent Jesus as a Savior. That's what he wants. Thank you for letting me be here tonight. Let's pray. Our Father, we don't know why you love us as much as you do. It's hard for us because we have trouble loving ourselves. We see so much bad within us that we confess to you. It's hard for us to believe you would really want us until we come into passages like this, are influenced by the teaching of someone like Paul who reminds us that you do keep your promise. And we know, Father, that you promised to save us, to forgive us, if we will but come to you penitently, confessing faith and turning from sin. Our Father, please don't stop loving us. Stay with us every moment of our life, even as we make that transition into eternity. May we do it safely in your hands. Thank you for this good church. Thank you for the faith of these people gathered here tonight. And because they have come, we pray for a very special blessing to be upon them. Would you grant that? And we will love you forever. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.